should we put anything on top of the worms?
Mm-hmm. Then we, yeah, that's where we add our 4-inch plug of browns. So
can I use some more of this?
Yeah, you want to pull up that corn? We can use some of that corn.
Oh, where did I do with the corn?
It's right in the box there.
Oh. Next to you. So this, the corn silks.
Is that dry?
This is too wet. Like I.
That's too wet. That's food.
Yeah. So we got some of
it
the.
Yeah.
Some of the dry stuff.
Technically, you know, this is not rocket surgery, so you can actually. It doesn't matter. You can.
Rocket
throw it
surgery.
It will either turn into a brown, or they can use it as a green if they need it.
They'll take these that are.
So they'll figure it out.
So one thing I noticed before, we put in pomegranate pieces.
They love pomegranate.
Wow, they were all, like, that was like a little nursery going on in the pomegranates.
And so there are certain foods, like a half of an avocado skin, or even an avocado, the piece that went bad on the counter. If you cut that off and put it in there, worms love it, and they actually do kind of use it like a nursery. As part of the colony. Pomegranates are like that. Yep.
So this is about half full now.
Yep.
So is that that's about a good place to, you don't have to keep doing it, right? You can, mm-hmm. So in a week. Nope.
So what you do is now we just wait, and we wait for a week to 2 weeks, and you'll know when you get it done, take kind of a measurement of how far it's down. Okay. And you can use a broomstick or something to measure. And with that measurement, then compare it in a week or two. What'll happen is all the fluff and everything that I put in there, the water from those vegetables is going to start soaking into the cardboard and things are going to get more compact. And once the volume of the tube has reduced by maybe half, then you can start feeding again. If you can actually see the compost or touch the compost, if you look at it, under your plug of browns, you pull out the browns, and any browns that are breaking down, you just throw in with the food. And then when you look at that compost, if you can see pieces of food identifiably in the compost, it's not time to feed them yet. That means that there's more scraps in there than they're able to process. Just let them work through that. And so when you don't see any scraps, that's when it's time to change or to add and to feed to the food worms.
Okay. So I've probably told people wrong on that too. So sorry, I've told everybody to like wait a couple weeks before they get their worms. So I guess you didn't need to do that.
Again, it's a flexible and forgiving system. And, you know, there is really no right way to do it. This is just what I found to be effective.
Beneficial.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, it's really hot in here today. Once you notice all of the compost starting to come down, right? Mm-hmm. Then you know, okay,
got some good worm activity.
And then you're going to take another, you know, handful of greens, mm-hmm. and throw in.
Yep.
And then another three or four handfuls of browns on top of that.
Yeah, about 3 or 4 to 1 is ideal. You can't get too many browns, but you can certainly get too much green, too much food.
So when it gets too green, how do you tell? Like, is it?
Well, there are certain things. First of all, it could stink, and that's a sign of the anaerobic. There is a smell to compost, but it doesn't stink. It doesn't smell septic. Past, you know, in the first week or two when you're doing it and building it, there might be a little bit of a whiff of a scent, but that goes quickly away. And so a compost column in balance does not stink. Sometimes you'll see an oily, like, in your leachate drawer.
Okay.
It'll be, the tea will be dark, but it'll be kind of oily, and that can be a sign that you're overfeeding your tea.
Ah, okay. So,
that and you'll have fruit flies.
Well, that was the next thing, right? Like, for me, for the ones that I've done and the ones that you've helped me with, they just smell earthy. They don't smell rotten.
Right.
But we do have a lot of people that ask and have had issues with fruit flies or rodents or whatever, and it's probably because it's stinking too much that they can actually,
right.
That's attracting them.
Or they're throwing a bunch of stuff on there raw and they're not covering it with something. Again, the browns act as a filter. And when people get an infestation, one of the things that we suggest is removing the stuff on top, the food on top, and sorting through it to get any worms, but usually they're not in that kind of environment. Putting a pantyhose on, you have to remove the contaminated material, best thing is to throw it out or remove it from the property so it doesn't just hatch out. And that way you can start with fresh, non-contaminated, because the eggs will hatch out. And then you put a pantyhose over the top of it, which acts as a screen or a filter.
Ooh, this is one thing I know about. I can answer for people. So you see on the lid, there's all these little holes. Those are there specifically for allowing air in, because it's an aerobic system, not an anaerobic system. But if you look inside the lid, there's these little ribs, and there's a little bit of space around the ribs till from the inside. So you could actually cut a piece of really fine mesh screen or pantyhose or something and tuck all around there. So you're still going to get the airflow from here, but you're making the holes from the back much smaller.
We've had a hard time finding a fine enough mesh screen that will prohibit fruit flies, which is one reason why we have not offered that.
Yeah, but so you could just put pantyhose right over the top of this, clip this on.
Or just put it over the top of the cap, either way.
Oh, yeah.
Again,
yeah,
it's flexible, matter. It's forgiving, it doesn't matter.
Okay, so we got all of our worms in there. Things have been going for a couple months, you know. How often do you empty the castings?
About every 30 days or so, you take a drawer or two out. As it gets to about 3/4 and you're starting to get all the way full, that's when it's time to think about getting a drawer or two of castings out of it.
Okay.
And so you open up the bottom of the base of the tower and kind of put your hand in to get it started. You might need a small tool, like a garden tablespoon or something like that.
I'm beating up my plants here. So you'd want to take the drawer out first to make sure there's no water in it, right? Water over it, put the drawer back in, and then pull the gate out.
Right, pull the compost gate out.
Tom is a tall dude, if you guys don't know. So in order for us to get him and this and me in the picture, we couldn't get the bottom half of the tower without the camera being, like, way far away. So you pull the drawer out, empty the water, put it back in, pull the gate out, and then stuff's going to fall out.
Hopefully. Not necessarily.
Okay. Well,
yeah, not necessarily. It does get kind of compact. Worm castings, like I said, they're dense, they're condensed, and they're wet. So you may have to work a little bit to get the stuff loosened up in the bottom.
Okay. So that was one of the questions. Like, if somebody takes a broom handle or a stick or something and, you know, pushes down to get it to release, is that going to hurt the worms?
No. Worms will be fine.
Okay.
You might clip one, but, or, you know, but it's...
Unlikely.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Here you go. So it's not going to hurt the worms. They're going to tell what you're doing, and they're probably going to be out of the way, before. It's just like everything else. They hear you, they're gone.
Yeah, you're just making some space in the bottom of the tower, and then with a broomstick, gently pushing it down, and push it down until it's back at the bottom again. Okay. You don't want any air gap in there.
So if you break it down, and then you loosen up whatever's holding it, and then everything drops, which has happened to me. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm beating up my plants. I might have to redo it. Sorry. Which has happened to me. I loosened, and then the whole column went, right? And so then if I pull out the drawer, there's still stuff falling, right? Over and over, you know, until I reach in and clear it all out by hand.
Uh-huh.
And so you can see what was worm castings. But if it all gets mixed in, how do you, like, figure out getting worm castings from other stuff?
Yeah, and basically what you do is, and I bring a couple buckets with me, a couple empty buckets. I have these or smaller ones, and just using a couple different containers, I'll put what's mostly castings in one container, what's mostly just dry composting material, browns that have no worms in it, in another container. And then I start sorting my worms and getting the worms out of it.
I'm going to move this so I stop hitting the plants.
Good plan. Should have thought of that before.
Do you have something that looks like what finished worm castings are? Do we have
any? We do, right here, actually.
So people have an idea of that.
And these are probably 80% done. And this was one of my little this ended up being my overwinter bin. I neglected my big bin and it had some issues, and so I had to start the colony over. These are the same worms that I've had for, what, 5 or 6 years now?
Yeah, probably. So the stuff on this side is the worm castings?
Yeah.
Like, this is, so you see that's fluffy, and this is all old bedding, right?
Right. Well, that's actually, that's a current pile. But there's not very many. That's where I took the worms out of.
Oh, there's one. Sorry. Yeah. Cover them back up.
Yeah, they like the dark.
So this is kind of what the worm castings will look like. They're light and fluffy, and they kind of feel like fresh potting soil.
Right.
Without the perlite and stuff in it, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So how much worm castings do you think I could put back in the tower after I harvest it? All of them, or?
Probably, I mean, you can use maybe a drawer. It's basically, you want to kind of just top it off, but mix it in a little bit and not disturb the roots of the plants too much. So you just kind of top mix it in. I mean, you could easily put a drawer on the tower, maybe a drawer and a half, two drawers.
Okay.
You don't want a compost worm castings to be any, it doesn't provide any benefit for the plants beyond 10 to 15% of any mix. Actually, worms or seeds don't germinate well in straight vermicompost and worm castings.
Really? Mm-hmm. I thought they'd be like, woohoo, look at all this fertilizer.
Nope.
Okay. So, what do you do with the rest of it then?
So, you can use it on your lawn, you can put it in your garden, you can give it to neighbors. People love vermicompost.
So, is it good for houseplants?
It's great for houseplants, yeah.
So, you can spread it around.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let me double check questions here. Somebody asked, how do the worms not fall out of the bottom of the tower?
So that's, they like being in that top 8 to 12 inches, but they do travel. Occasionally people do find them in their drawer, and we don't know what the reason is, but it's not unusual to find a couple every now and again. There's a baffle on the compost gate that prevents most of the stuff from falling.
Let me grab a compost gate.
4 inches of browns makes kind of a filter for right now because it's fluffy and it's not compacted, it's not super soaking wet. And so if worms end up in the drawer, it's because they went there for some reason.
So here's a, I'm not taking this out since we just filled it. So here's a compost gate or filter. So it goes in, if you can see, there's a lip. And this is what you're talking about as far as the baffle, right? Mm-hmm. So when you put it in, this raised side goes in first, and then the compost column sets on this. And so it keeps everything from falling out into the drawer.
And right? that's a great point, too, is that I pack this fairly tight, even though I didn't really compress it a lot. It probably wouldn't inhibit the gate, it wouldn't fall into the drawer, but often when people start their compost columns and they're curious, and then they pull the gate out, and the compost will fall into the drawer. So that's especially on a new tower.
Right.
That's it. You're just starting it up. Don't open the compost gate.
Resist the urge. I have done that on a couple times because I was anxious to see how it was going, and it was a mess. So, patience is a virtue in this case.
Voice of experience.
<All right.
laughs> Yeah.
So, if you want to grab something while I check, grab your drink while I'm checking these questions out. I think I might have missed a couple. Sorry, people.
If you're not a part of the garden, if you're not a part of the garden training project, that's another good place to get answers to all these questions.
Oh, yeah. So, I'll give you a chance to get a drink there. So, if you're on Facebook, which I'm assuming you are because this is a Facebook Live event, we have a Facebook user group called Garden Training Project. It's linked on our linked on the Facebook page, right?
On our, Garden Power Project Facebook page.
Yeah.
And the Garden Training Project.
And if you don't see it, you can just do a search for all one word, Garden Training Project. And then they can join.
Mm-hmm.
And there's, Tom set up some questions on there to keep spammers and bots and stuff like that out. So you have to answer a couple questions really quick.
Simple questions. There are no wrong answers.
It's just like a yes-no kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Just a screening, because bots can't answer those questions. And we have, what is it, like 7,000 users?
7,000 members. It's really a wonderful community, actually. It's an amazing place.
So Tom wrote a document on, and several other people have posted documents on the do's and don'ts, how to get started with vermicomposting, mm-hmm. answering the basics. All of those files are in the file section of Garden Training Project. So once you've joined, you can go in and look at all of the user documents and the composting documents and people's suggestions and look at all the pictures and... there's a lot of stuff happening there. So if you're not on there, I'd highly suggest that you get on there. Let me check this one out. Can you use manure?
Oh, that's a great question, too. That is a really good question. Only if it's been hot composted. Now, there is discussion, and people do use rabbit pellets. But that can be kind of a danger in a sense that because it's not necessarily separated from the urine, it can contain a lot of ammonia. And so the best thing, and also that's another great point, Christy, is that vermicomposting as opposed to hot composting. In hot composting, the temperatures get so high that it kills bacteria, it kills pathogens and things like that.
Oh, yeah.
Vermicomposting, while the worms do have some antibacterial activity along with all the beneficial microorganisms
easy for
in
you
the
to
compost
say.
Kind, not so easy for me to say, it doesn't have the protection that hot composting does. So that's one reason why we caution, you don't want to, people, this is an inevitable question, can I compost my dog poop? Not the best idea. Okay, there's too many bacteria in there that are not copacetic for this system, and so that is not a good idea. If the compost, if it's been manure that's been hot composted and aged, that would be fine.
Aged previously.
That's right, that's right. Manure is very high nitrogen. High nitrogen things are things that raise temperature when they're put in volume. Getting back to the coffee grounds. Coffee grounds are very high nitrogen. And when you get too many of them in one place, or lawn clippings, that's another one, fresh grass. That's a green. You can use that as a food. Because there's not the high temperatures of that, you don't want to use manure just straight like it is. There's too much risk of bacterial contamination. But the other thing about the coffee grounds and the lawn clippings is that I mix them in with other vegetable scraps. So you're not
lawn
like
clippings
a
is a big
clump.
One. People want to use their lawn. It's an obvious source of greens.
And I alluded to the pulp from juicing. The pulp from juicing will do that too, where it's so compact, it's actually anaerobic because it's made too small. And so that pulp you should mix with other things.
Okay.
So don't put it in a big glot.
People are having problems finding browns. You know, like people, especially like if you're all vegetarian and you're juicing and everything, you have greens out the wazoo.
It's good to
where do you find browns?
It's good to have multiple sources you can find. You have to be kind of creative with your browns. Grocery bags work really well. I don't like to ask for them, but I do occasionally if we don't have enough Amazon packing paper.
Or other packing paper.
There's other,
not just Amazon.
Yeah, anything that's brown. And people ask, you know, you can use any shredded paper. People will ask, can I shred or can I compost my junk mail, or can I compost newspaper? And well, it's kind of a philosophical question at some point, because if you're very careful about what you eat and you don't like to eat a lot of sugar and you watch for chemicals and try to stay whole grain, brown rice, organic, then you probably want to only compost brown materials. Brown papers have the least amount of processing possible. The glues are pretty innocuous and not chemically advanced, and so they're pretty simple. And that's a much better, much healthier option. However, if you eat Wonder Bread, processed foods, packaging, don't care about dyes, drink Diet Cokes every day, then go ahead and compost your junk mail.
So let's make the assumption that a lot of people are not going to compost their junk mail. So they could go to the hardware store and just buy a bale of straw.
Yep.
Right?
Yep. They sell smaller, more manageable ones at pet stores, actually.
Oh.
You can get Timothy hay or alfalfa.
Oh, so like where you would go and get... So I used to have a rabbit, and we would get those little small bales of hay and alfalfa.
Yeah, or they sell them this big. You know,
yeah. But so that you could use as well if you don't have enough browns available.
Sure, yes.
So somebody posted, which I think we probably just answered this for them, but they said that their compost seems really wet and was told, which I think I might have said, it was supposed to be like a squeezed out sponge, like, the moisture content, and theirs isn't. So how do they correct that?
That's a great question. And the answer would be more browns. And oftentimes in composting, in vermicomposting with worms, that's the answer is more browns. It means that there's too many fresh, wet vegetables breaking down.
Okay.
You know, things like tomatoes have a lot of water. If you know, there's a piece of tomato that's bad and you cut it off, and you get a lot of those scraps that have a lot of water content in them, it makes things
really
damp.
Celery has a lot of water.
Yeah.
So if it's gotten too wet already, you know, just adding like 4 inches of browns on top isn't going to help what's on the bottom.
Correct.
So do you
correct.
Suggest, I haven't had to do this, but so do you suggest that you just empty it and have those buckets and then kind of rebuild it again with more browns?
That would be the ideal way to do it. You don't have to do that, but that would be fine.
Okay.
That would be fine.
So... I think that that's a question that a lot of people have had now that they're learning more.
It will age and drain somewhat naturally. You don't have to, but that would be a good answer.
For some reason, my screen keeps deciding it wants to be in a different direction than before. So we'll let my screen catch up here, and I'll bring up a couple of the other questions that people have asked that I remember. Without seeing that. So now that we're all done, started, say it's 3 months later, we've taken some compost out. Like, what do you need to do to maintain it through the season? And should you, that was one question. I should have asked this before. Cause I'm curious. So, sorry, my mind's bouncing a little bit. They wanted to know if we added sand or eggshells in here when we did it. And we didn't this time.
No, we didn't, no. But I do have powdered eggshells, not powdered, but finely ground eggshells. You can just dry your eggshells in a toaster oven. I've heard of people microwaving it, but to each their own. There's no wrong answer. Yeah. There's a bunch of ways to do it. And then when they're dry, you just put them in a bag. We recycle some of the bags that we use from composting. Put the eggs in it, and then crush them with a rolling pin. And so the sand-sized particles are what they like. Eggshell takes a long time to break down. It's great for the garden. It provides calcium. It's slow dissolve, very slow dissolve.
So if you just
crush them up with your hand and put them in there, you could use a little bit of sand. You don't need much, though. They don't need a lot, but a little bit.
So just like chickens and the gizzard
component, right.
Like they just need a little bit of dirt to
The benefit for the calcium is that it helps with the babies and it helps them make cocoons. So it actually is very good for their fertility to do a little bit of the very finely crushed eggshell.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So I can tell you what I do. When I grill, I only use charcoal. So after I'm done grilling, I take my eggshells and I throw them in... aluminum foil or parchment paper or something like that, and I throw them on the grill and just let them sit there while the rest of the charcoal finishes off, and then I take them out the next day. And they're nice and toasty brown, but they stink a little, just to let you know.
And the reason for doing that is it actually changes the calcium, and it actually increases the amount of phosphorus. That little bit of browning has a reaction.